So good evening, everybody. The Center of Excellence for Clinical Management of COVID-19 at AIIMS Bhopal would like to welcome you all for the fourth webinar of the ongoing webinar series. These webinars are conducted on first four Fridays of every month. As we are aware, a highly infectious respiratory tract disease, COVID-19, can cause extensive lung damage. Pulmonary rehabilitation is crucial both admitted and discharged patients in COVID-19. In today's webinar, Dr. Alkesh would throw light on pulmonary rehabilitation for patients with COVID-19. And I'm pretty sure this talk would benefit the doctors and nurses attending. And let this talk be a motivation for all of you to start the respiratory rehabilitation centers in your workplaces. And let me introduce Dr. Alkesh. Dr. Alkesh Khurana is an experienced clinician, researcher, and teacher. He works as an associate professor in pulmonary medicine at AIIMS Bhopal. Dr. Alkesh, over to you. The platform is yours from now on.
Thank you, Nitin. Thank you very much. Thank you for the introduction. So we discussed today a very, very important and yet a topic which has not been given due importance, not only in COVID-19, but also in general in respiratory diseases. But somehow it's good that this topic, I presume, will gain more recognition that it requires because of COVID-19 and its sequelae, which we are facing for the last few months now. So we start with the session now. And the first slide is basically a case scenario. Anyone of us who has seen even a few patients of COVID-19 in the last 10 months now must have come across this scenario in our practice in the last few months. Just consider this scenario. A 54-year-old male diabetic is being shifted to your ward after a 3-week stay in the ICU after being on ventilator for COVID-19 pneumonia. So a lot of people have played a very important role in getting this patient weaned off from the ventilator, severe COVID ARDS and what. Currently, that patient is still on nasal prongs, on 3 liters of oxygen, and on antibiotics, low-dose steroids, and anticoagulation. So what more can you offer to this patient? So it's not a quizzer kind of a thing. Obviously, we are talking about rehab, so answer is rehab. But this is just to bring to your mind that this kind of a state of patient, which we all have faced and come across in the last few months, and at one point of time, we feel a bit helpless. Even after getting the patient weaned off of the ventilator and discharged from the ICU. So what more can you offer to this patient? So after going through the next few slides, we'll come to this slide again in the end so as to have a better and a clear answer to what can we offer to this patient. So in this presentation, we will discuss about basically the definition of rehabilitation, existing data, if any exists on rehabilitation and COVID-19, the components of rehab, the methodology by which you can actually ask the patient to undergo the rehabilitation sessions, what outcomes are to be taken in consideration for quantification or statistical measurements and whatever, and what are the barriers which we face while enrolling patients for rehabilitation, especially in COVID-19. So the definition of rehabilitation is the same, which there is no new definition of rehab for COVID-19 as such. There is a general definition for rehabilitation, pulmonary rehabilitation, which is quite old now. It's a comprehensive multidisciplinary intervention for patients with chronic respiratory disease, which includes thorough patient assessment at the baseline, and very importantly highlighted is patient-tailored therapies. The customary, the simile which we label as one size does not fit all, this actually applies to rehabilitation. You cannot prescribe a single or a similar set of exercises to all the patients. The therapies are patient tailored. Every therapy, every session is individualized to the particular patient. And in addition, it includes exercise training, education, behavioral changes, which lead to improvement in physical and psychological condition of the patient, and with an ultimate goal of long-term health enhancing behaviors. So this is a very big definition. I have further split the definition into many parts so as to just show that this definition itself is very vast and self-explanatory. It explains what rehab means actually. So the short-term goals of pulmonary rehabilitation are to alleviate dyspnea and alleviate anxiety, And the long-term goals obviously include improve the overall quality of life of the patient and to facilitate the patient's return to daily life, daily day-to-day routine activities after having spent so many days in the hospital, either in the ICU or in the HDUs. We should know that the pulmonary rehabilitation has an established role with maximal benefit only for COPD till date. It has a role in other respiratory diseases also, but the most established role still is with COPD. That is a gold standard kind of a thing. So when we compare the effects of rehab in any other respiratory disease, whether it is COVID or anything else, we usually tend to compare the results with, okay, this was the result in COPD, which was considered as the gold standard, and so these are the results in the other conditions. So we can enroll the patients either on COPD, either on OPD basis, sorry, or you can, if the patient is in-house, you can enroll the patient after a couple of weeks of discharge from the hospital. And COPD is one condition where there is a significant documentation in improvement in quality of life and exercise capacity of the patient. So there are a lot of other diseases other than COPD where pulmonary rehabilitation has been tried with good results, but not as good as the results in COPD. Asthma, bronchiectasis, interstitial lung diseases, pulmonary hypertension, neuromuscular diseases, lung cancer, thoracic surgeries, transplantation, everywhere it has been tried with good results, but not as good as COPD. So now we come to what is the existing data or literature about COVID and rehab, if there is any till now. You must understand that the available data in terms of proper RCTs or proper cohort studies is available for SARS, which was there around a decade earlier. Okay, and this COVID-19 has now been, people have experienced and come to and some opinions that this COVID-19 is also different from SARS. Although we know that COVID-19 is much more infectious in transmissibility as compared to SARS, but the dysfunction, the residual pulmonary dysfunction or the fibrosis which was there was much more common with SARS. And we have had webinars in the last few weeks, and we are now discussing it with our colleagues all over the country. And most of the people are now coming of the opinion that COVID-19 fibrosis is not that common as the terminology has been made to be labeled as COVID-19 fibrosis. Usually people, actually patients, are tending to getting resolution of the fibrosis on its own over a period of few months in the last 6 to 8 months experience. So the existing literature is there on SARS, but not in COVID-19 in terms of proper cohort studies or RCTs. When we talk about SARS, the existing literature, there was a big study of 133 patients where rehab was offered to patients of SARS, and which led to significant improvement in 600 walk distance, SF-36 as a measure of quality of life and rates of oxygen consumption. So beneficial results of rehab are available in SARS in terms of studies, not in COVID-19. If you talk about COVID-19, these two slides are actually full of literature and existing data about COVID-19 in the last 10 months. Now, just spend 1 minute on these two slides. You see, this is the existing data or literature about rehab and COVID-19. Most of this literature is either a letter to editor, an expert opinion, letter to editor, you can see case report based letter to editor, and short communication, review, position paper, and short communication. So this is the existing literature about rehab at COVID-19. Most of the short communications, editorials, expert opinions, recommendations do suggest that you should use COVID rehab for COVID-19 as with any other respiratory etiology to gain maximal benefits. But all these literature is not based on an RCT or a proper long-term cohort study, because we hardly had last 6 months to conduct such studies and to get our results. Maybe we will have such kind of a literature by the end of this year or in the second half of this year. But as of now, most of the data exists is about short communications and expert opinions and all that stuff. So what are the basic components of rehabilitation? When we offer rehabilitation to any particular patient, be it COVID-19 or any other respiratory disease, it includes basically aerobic exercises. Aerobic exercises are like, you are not giving something like bodybuilding or weightlifting to the patient. It is like walking, treadmill, cycle, ergometry, something like this. And then there are anaerobic and strength training exercises, which are the weight bearing exercises or the weight lifting exercises. These are the basic components or the main two components of a rehabilitation program. Then specifically some respiratory exercises, patient education, nutritional intervention, and psychological intervention. So these are the basic components of any rehabilitation program, especially in respiratory disease. But as I said earlier, these are individualized, customized to every patient after having a thorough assessment at the baseline. You cannot prescribe a similar set of an exercises printed on a paper and start giving it to every patient who's enrolled in rehab. That just cannot happen. So what is the schedule of the PR programs? See, once again, I'll repeat this, that this modality or this methodology of rehabilitation is being extrapolated from COPD based on the feasibility and practicality in Indian setting. These guidelines are actually the BTS or the ATS guidelines for rehabilitation are basically there for COPD and some other respiratory diseases. We are extrapolating this data or this methodology to COVID-19 ICU or HDU survivors and then trying to bring it to some logistical, realistical state so that the patient can complete the sessions. So we offer the patients minimum of 2 to 3 sessions per week, not less than 6 weeks or not more than 12 weeks, which is a bit difficult to carry, but 6 to 12 weeks of enrollment, 2 to 3 times per week. And we evaluate the patient at 0 and 6 weeks, that is before starting the rehab and after the ending of the sessions of rehab. In some patients, 12 weeks, if the patient is able to still come to the rehab sessions, then we can extend it to further 12 weeks. And on the days when the patient is not coming, ideally, all patients, we do prescribe them home-based sessions, simulating the hospital-based sessions on the days not visiting the hospital. So what are the baseline evaluation or the outcome parameters which we do at 0 weeks and then at the 6 weeks after the patient is done with the rehabilitation program? We do a basic pulmonary function testing, a 6-minute walk test or an incremental shuttle walk test to quantify or objectively label the patient's exercise capacity. Quality of life questionnaire in terms of SGRQ, SF-36 or baseline or transitional dyspnea index. Look at that quality of life which does not reflect the patient's chronic state beforehand, because patients of COVID-19 were usually living a normal life till 2 to 3 months back. So the questionnaire should be reflecting an acute deterioration in health status and not a chronic deterioration in health status. Nutritional assessment by fat-free mass index, preferably, if not possible, by BMI. And psychological assessment in terms of, there are many questionnaires available, Hamilton anxiety or depression scales. We in our place, we use DAS-21, that is depression, anxiety, stress scale 21, which we find it more convenient to use. Also, please understand that you are not expected to find significant improvements in pulmonary function test in 6 weeks time. You are not expected to label or to say improvement in patients anthropometric measurements over 6 weeks time. So these are basically more of predictors rather than the comparative parameters at 0 and 6 weeks. But you are expected to find some significant difference in 6-minute walk test, which reflects the patient exercise capacity, and the quality of life questionnaires and the psychological assessment. You are expected to find improvements in this 6-minute walk test, quality of life and psychological assessment, but not in anthropometric measurements and not in PFTs over a 6-week period of time. So you can, usually we will be focusing on the patients where we can offer them after discharge from the hospital, you can offer them enrollment into the rehabilitation program. But actually speaking, when the patient is still in the hospital, the patient has shifted from ICU to your ward before being discharged, actually the rehabilitation has started then and there only. When you teach the patient breathing exercises in the ward, you ask or you help the patient get mobilized from the bed, you encourage different positionings, bronchial hygiene techniques. These all are a part of rehabilitation only, which basically has started itself there in the ward only. And the moment you start, the patient starts experiencing benefits or perceives benefits from these things, then he or she is more motivated to enroll in your OPD-based rehab program as well. These are some special precautions which you have to take. These are again extrapolated from cystic fibrosis patients. We do not see cystic fibrosis patients in our setup. Obviously, in India, cystic fibrosis is not that common, but when rehab sessions are prescribed to patients of cystic fibrosis in the Western world, they make sure that there is no overcrowding. There are only 1 to 2 patients in each session, and there are optimal safety precautions there. So these kind of precautions have been extrapolated from cystic fibrosis to COVID-19. Not only that the patient has turned COVID negative, okay, the patient is not very infectious, but most of these patients who are coming to your rehab in the visits are still on low dose steroids. They are immunocompromised. So it is more wise to avoid overcrowding in your rehab sessions. And if possible, don't call for 1-2 patients in each session so as to avoid cross-infection and prevent any kind of nosocomial infection to these patients. And you obviously got to have optimal safety precautions for your staff also who is there. And as I just mentioned, just like CF patients, COVID patients must follow adequate physical distancing, or as you call a single patient, and patients with poor FEV1 or DLCO less than 65 are more likely to be saturated in the exercise. As I just mentioned 2 minutes back, the pulmonary function tests are more of predictors rather than you expect a significant statistical significant increase in these values after 6 weeks. No, they are more of predictors how the patient will behave in the rehab sessions. So you can like have your things ready in case the patients get sick in the sessions. So another couple of slides about pulmonary hypertension in COVID. Since we know now by enough literature that COVID-19 is a kind of a coagulopathy, where there is a procoagulant state in the ICUs when the patients are there. So a lot of these patients will have pulmonary hypertension and concomitantly, especially if there is a documented thrombotic episode in the ICU or in the HDU, then definitely hypertension should be there. One more reason, I'll just come to the next slide, that usually now we know that COVID patients are having mostly they are diabetics, hypertensives, obese, and with metabolic syndromes. So all these factors are also predisposed to pulmonary hypertension. So there is an expected good possibility that COVID patients will have pulmonary hypertension when you enroll them for rehab, which is actually a challenging aspect. So you can tolerate some amount of hypoxia, exercise-induced desaturation in COVID patients, but when concomitant pulmonary hypertension is present, then you be very careful with the resting oxygen saturation must be more than 90% before enrollment, and you should terminate the physiotherapy sessions as soon as SpO2 drops below 90. You can, to some extent, tolerate some exercise-induced hypoxemia, but not in patients with concomitant pulmonary hypertension. And the second important thing is that in this subset of patients, we should avoid exercises which lead to increased intrathoracic pressures. For example, the strength training exercises of the upper limbs, the weightlifting by the upper limbs, these exercises tend to increase intrathoracic pressures. So these exercises should be avoided in this subset of patients. Okay, so basically, if there is pulmonary hypertension in COVID, which is likely in good number of patients, so you should rather focus on low intensity aerobic exercises like treadmill or stretching. Or these kind of exercises would be the mainstay of your rehab sessions. And if the patient is on anti-PH drugs, you should obviously ensure compliance. And dizziness, syncopal attacks during exercise is an ominous sign with concomitant PHs present. And if you can have a standby cardiologist, obviously cardiologist cannot be there in your rehab session, but on the same floor, even then it is good enough. Then you don't expect that if you prescribe 10 to 15 minutes of a session to a rehab patient, even at 3 km/h treadmill, that patient will on one go complete 10 minutes of session in one go. It is, you may find patients who are not able to do so. So it is more wise, yes, as I said earlier, the exercise sessions are more individualized and customized. So it is more wise to let the patient do a treadmill walking for 3 minutes, then take rest, then again take for 3 minutes, then again take rest, and then you complete the 10 minutes of your prescribed exercise. This is called as interval training, because these patients are expected to resolve over a longer period of time. Exercise-induced desaturations are more expected as compared to COPD or any other respiratory disease. So interval training, that is breaking up of exercise sessions into small sessions, might be more relevant in this subset of patients rather than asking the patients to complete your sessions in one go. Duration of rehab program, how long you have to call to the patients. So as I just, again, I will say that the methodology has been extrapolated from COPDs and other respiratory diseases. So 6 to 12 weeks is what we are doing and what most people who are actually and doing rehab in COVID, they are doing. And it has been seen that the benefits of rehabilitation do not last long in non-COPD respiratory diseases. So if you can, if your patients can come to the sessions beyond 6 weeks, it is good enough. But since the logistics are a big issue in Indian setup, we will come to that on the end of the slides also. So that is one big limiting factor. But however, if your patient can come to 12, can come for 12 weeks, it is wise to call the patients for 12 weeks. You expect hypothetically, as seen in the non-COPD respiratory conditions, that the benefits tend to last longer if the PR sessions are given for a longer duration of time. Since these patients are still recovering from the underlying COVID-19 disease, so if in case any of these events happen, this is an indication for premature termination of rehab sessions and give the patient a rest or a break and then reassess. Saturation, I have written here less than 90%, which is applicable if there is a concomitant comorbidity in terms of pulmonary hypertension or something else. But ideally, some amount of exercise-induced desaturation you can tolerate. Palpitations, dizziness, chest pain, increasing Borg dyspnea scale more than 4, these are the indications, okay, the patient is not tolerating my rehab session, it is better to wise to stop, terminate, and then reassess the patient. Now, again, as most of these patients we know are having concomitant diabetes, hypertension, metabolic syndromes, all the time we have a couple of patients who are significantly morbidly obese in the ICUs. So once these patients are tracheostomized, weaned off from the ICU, come to your ward, and then you offer them rehab, you expect especially these obese patients to have an underlying sleep disordered breathing also. So you must ask these patients to undergo a screening tool for sleep disordered breathing and then evaluate if the screening tool is positive for sleep studies or accordingly seek a prescription or whatever it comes out to be later on after you have screened them from OSA. But in that obese subgroup of patients, this should not be missed. There are some other general adjuvants in rehab like smoking cessation, which holds true for any respiratory condition, early mobilization, adequate nutrition, and psychiatric assessment. Just a couple of slides about nutrition and psychiatric assessment. Nutrition is an integral part of any rehab program. BMI is usually not a reliable parameter, but can be taken. What we follow in our setup is fat-free mass index, which is just a mathematical calculation based on some anthropometric measurements. You can Google it and there are calculators available for fat-free mass index, which we usually follow in our place. So it is better predictor of nutrition as a predictor for outcomes in rehabilitation rather than generalizing as BMI, obese or not obese or what. Most COVID patients we know are diabetics, hypertensive, so you should ideally give them a good diet chart accordingly with less sugar, less salt, but optimal proteins. Psychiatric assessment, again, is an integral component. This is one component where you see results within few weeks of time. Okay, exercise capacity in terms of 6-minute walk test, and then psychiatric assessment or psychological assessment. You see good results in 6 to 10 weeks of time in this. So most of the literature available for respiratory conditions has used Hamilton anxiety and depression scores. We follow DAS scores in our place, depression, anxiety, stress scales to measure at 0 and 6 weeks. We find it just more convenient. Although Hamilton scales have been more widely used in respiratory conditions in the available literature, but some psychological assessment at baseline and as an outcome parameter must be done to document the success or failure of your rehab program. So now we again come back to the same slide which we started earlier. See, you have that 54-year-old diabetic male shifted to out of ICU for 3 weeks, currently on nasal prongs 3 liter. Apart from antibiotics, low-dose steroids, and anticoagulation, what more can be offered to this patient? The first and the foremost question we ask this patient is, okay, where do you live? Where do you live? Because if we are going to offer you a rehab program, is there a practical feasibility to enroll in the rehab program? If the patient lives 60 kilometers away from my hospital, then practically the hospital-based sessions are completely out of question and that patient can only be convinced to participate in some tele-rehabilitation or home-based sessions, which is a bit more difficult to get through. So the first thing is to ask the patient if there is any feasibility to enroll in the PR program. If the patient says yes, it is wise to wait for the patient to wean off oxygen requirement and let the patient come to the room where this is not written anywhere. People in the West with good setups do rehab even on oxygen also. But based on our practical experience and logistics, we better ask the patient to wait for 1, 2, 3 weeks to get the patient weaned off the oxygen requirement. And in COVID, it is an experience from us as well as from colleagues, even other parts of the country also, that in due course of time, either 1 month or 3 months, the survivors usually get off oxygen. There are very less number of patients who are actually left with domiciliary oxygen requirement. They will get off oxygen in due course of time. So once that stage is achieved, so in this particular patient, it is better to wait for a couple of weeks before this patient gets off oxygen, who is currently on nasal prongs at 3 liters per minute. Then you ask the patient to come in the session. Then you do a complete thorough baseline assessment in terms of 6-minute walk test, pulmonary function tests, anthropometry to measure the fat-free mass index, psychological assessment in terms of DAS-21 or Hamilton anxiety and depression scores, and a 2D echo to basically grossly look for pulmonary hypertension, which is a very important but a ominous concomitant finding in these patients. So you do a thorough baseline assessment with these things, then start with 2 to 3 weeks of supervised sessions in the hospital-based setting. You should ideally be able, the patient should be able to undergo 15 to 20 minutes of treadmill and to 10 to 15 minutes of weight-bearing exercises, if not at the starting, but at least at the end of the session. At the starting, the patient may be only able to do 2, 3, 4 minutes of walking. So you better start with interval sessions for these patients. And then by the time the rehab sessions are complete, you gradually increase the duration of your exercise sessions and the sets of exercise, what we call as 3 sets, 4 sets, 5 sets. And at the end of the sessions, the patient should be able to undergo 15 to 20 minutes of aerobic and 10 to 15 minutes of energy exercises. So then you reassess the patient at 6 weeks or 12 weeks, how long the patient has done, and then you do the comparative assessment of your baseline parameters and outcome parameters to quantify the results. So there is a very good review article just in this session of Lung India, which was published this year by people in Manipal, I think. So they basically have written on the barriers of rehabilitation enrollment across all respiratory diseases throughout the country. And we know that there are barriers, obviously, which are there. And logistically, it is the most important, if you ask me, the single most important factor in rehabilitation enrollment is family support and the logistics of transportation and the distance issues. The more nearer the patient's house is, residence is nearer to the hospital, the more likelihood is that the patient will come to your rehab session and complete the rehab sessions. The farther away the patient, the difficult more it is. And rehab till now is not insurance covered in any of the companies, to the best of my knowledge. So even for paying patients, it is difficult. So the other thing is existence of a PR center and awareness. Most of the people outside my hospital might not even know that there is a rehab center here, so we can refer the patients here. So awareness of rehabilitation programs is also one big barrier. And the other thing is lack of interdisciplinary team effort. You cannot run a rehab center all alone. You've got to have people, 2, 3, 4 people from different specialties to put in their efforts to complete this program. Then one slide about tele-rehabilitation. As I just said, that the days on which the patient is not coming to the hospital, the patient is supposed to do a simulation kind of a thing at home. Or if the patient just cannot come to the hospital, you have to teach patients some exercises which the patient can carry out at home. That is tele-rehabilitation. So since in times of COVID-19, it is more difficult for the patients to get facilities for transportation. The mobilization is farther more difficult than in routine times. So tele-rehabilitation actually comes more into play and picture. If somebody can develop a tele-rehabilitation program, it will be very good in rehab. It should be incorporated into the main rehab program. Then there is something called as intelligent rehabilitation. Everything nowadays, you include a mobile-based app and it becomes intelligent. So in just 2-3 months back, there was a paper published in BMJ about an ongoing RCT in Wuhan itself, where there is a patient who downloads the app, undergoes a self-assessment questionnaire as directed, And then accordingly, the patient is given some videos, which the patient downloads videos for exercise prescriptions and does the exercise himself or herself at home. And that app or the usage of that app is remotely monitored by a healthcare worker as a data ID is transferred to management terminal, and the healthcare worker intervenes from the remote site as and when required. So it's a more sophisticated, advanced way of home rehabilitation, which is intelligent rehabilitation. If anyone can get in collaboration with some IT sector and try to develop it, it will be more than good for the patients. So to summarize, pulmonary rehabilitation has a wide scope of implementation for COVID-19. Benefits may be less long-lasting and lesser than in COPD, but they are definitely present, as also opined by a number of expert opinions all across the world. It's a very low-cost setup, but a highly effective facility. If you ask me personally, I always say it takes only a few 50,000 rupees to 1 lakh rupees to set up a rehab center, not more than that. If you want to make it more sophisticated, want to include a CPAP machine, it costs much more, but that is not an integral part. In less than 1 lakh rupees or 50,000 rupees to 1 lakh, you can actually set up a rehab center at your hospital. And you must encourage early enrollment of the patients. Patients, there is a slight difference from other diseases. Patients with exercise-induced desaturation and myopathy, which is quite common in COVID, don't deny the patients rehab. Accept those patients, but with a bit of caution. And hence, implementation of rehab programs should be encouraged in all hospitals treating severe COVID pneumonia as an integral part. These are some of the differences. Thank you very much. Yes, Daniel. Any questions, any queries are more than welcome. I'll be able to see if I can answer any of them.
Thank you, Dr. Alkesh, for taking us through the presentation. It was interesting. Now, I would like to request the participants, like if they have any questions, they can drop in the chat box or they can unmute themselves and ask questions.
Good evening, sir.
Yes.
I wanted to. Sir, I wanted to ask that if we have a patient who is on requirement, oxygen requirement, 1 to 2 liters, and he has been on this oxygen requirement for nearly about 1 month after COVID, and he has taken steroids for that, and now the only option left is pulmonary rehab. And if this patient has a desaturation during our rehab exercises, so can we prophylactically increase the oxygen during the rehab to 3 to 4 liters and get him so that he can do the rehab exercises properly for the time he's coming for rehab?
I'll just share one of the experiences of one of our patients. There are must be some of my colleagues here listening to this. We had a patient recently in our ICU who was discharged from the hospital after 3 months of stay. That patient, I will obviously not name that patient, but that was a lady, around 50, 55 years old lady. She was there in ICU for around 1 month. After 1 month, we could recustomize and wean off that patient. Then that patient was in our ward for around 2 months. So I was the one who was pushing that patient to get discharged, but her husband was so used to care about her wife that he was reluctant to go from the hospital. And at 88 days, we discharged that patient at room air. Okay, so I will again reemphasize our personal experience that wait for some time. These patients, this so-called post-COVID fibrosis in our experience is a kind of a misnomer. So the patients who are survivors will come back to room air at a certain point of time after a few weeks. So rather than enrolling that patient early for rehab, I would rather suggest wait for one more month. That patient is more expected to come to room air with time, and then you enroll that patient for rehab.
Okay.
There is a question.
Yes.
There is a question. Any guidelines for rehab in children? Pulmonary rehab.
This is a question by Dr. Bhavna. Dr. Bhavna, sorry, I have not come across any guidelines for rehab in children till now. We have been working on our center for the last 1 to 1.5 years now. And whatever literature we have studied and we have practiced so far, we have not come across any guidelines for children so far. If you've come across, please let me know.
Participants are encouraged to ask questions.
The only thing it requires rehab is meticulous record keeping. Okay, and the persistent motivation of the patients. It's not we tend to set up costly equipments in our hospitals. We tend to buy, the hospitals tend to buy a lot of costly equipments. Rehab does not cost the hospital much. It's a very low cost setup, but with very, very good results. We have had patients in the past, some bedridden patients also who have been able to resume jobs also after later on, not COVID, but some other diseases previously. So it's a very low cost, highly effective equipment. So the hospital should be encouraged to have setups of rehabilitation in their premises. It just takes one room and less than 1 lakh rupees to set up a center.
Sir, I wanted to ask one more question. Sir, for monitoring of rehab, what all tools are used? Like one is questionnaire, one is clinical assessment, one is 6-minute walk test, and sir, spirometry should be used, and any other parameter should is also there that should be checked. And after how much frequency?
These are the basic parameters which we do. As I said, that spirometry is not expected to improve over 6 to 12 weeks. You do not expect any improvement, but it is more of a predictor how the patients will behave in the next 6 weeks to 12 weeks after the rehab program. Cardiopulmonary testing exercise equipment itself is the most sophisticated equipment for rehabilitation, which tells you the oxygen consumption actually in terms of liters per minute or all that stuff, which is much more sophisticated equipment for better prediction and delineating between cardiac and respiratory components of and all that. But that is a very costly equipment. That costs around 25 to 30 lakh rupees. And one sophisticated equipment actually increases the cost of your center so much, hence it is not a mandatory part of your rehabilitation. These basic things only can help a lot to get the patient through this sessions of rehabilitation.
Okay, sir.
So there's one more question.
Yes, sir.
Are there any clinical parameters or tests which can predict success in pulmonary rehabilitation?
Yes, sir. For non-COVID patients, there are papers written earlier on non-COVID diseases. There are published literature is available about determinants of success in rehabilitation programs. That is there. You can go through that literature, you will find. Just a couple of minutes back, Dr. Prakhar asked this question that if the patient is still on oxygen. So there are papers on non-COVID patients previously in the literature that the more sick the patient is, the less likely the patient is expected to complete the rehab program, and the default is more to be higher. Okay, so extremes of the condition, extreme sick patient or extreme good patient, that is a very patient with very mild disease, both these extremes are less likely, will give you patients who are less likely to complete the rehab session and will lead to more of default rates. So you have to have ideal choice of enrollment of your patient. So for this particular thing, you will find enough literature in the net, but not for COVID, for other respiratory conditions.
Sir, is there any literature or is there any your experience that any untoward incident happened with a COVID patient during rehabilitation?
Not like, so far. Are the chances? Touchwood, not so far. There is one question that if a person is recovered from COVID, are there chances that he would transmit the infection after recovery to? See, we don't presume that. We presume the patient to be non-infectious after 7 to 10 days, in fact. But once the patient is discharged from the hospital, usually all our patients at the time of discharge do undergo COVID testing, and they are always negative usually. Or not usually, but always they are negative when they are discharged from the hospital. So the measures of social distancing and sanitization, etc., are basically because these patients are already on steroids, these patients are more immunocompromised, and they are more prone to infections. That is why the sanitization measures or these things are, or optimal safety distancing measures are required for COVID patients. Not because that they will be transmitting COVID even after coming home after 1 month of discharge from the hospital. They are more prone. So that is why these measures are more important.
Sir, Dr. P. N. Agarwal has a question. Could you please ask?
Yes, sir. Dr. P. N. Agarwal. Yes, sir.
Please. It was an excellent presentation.
Thank you, sir.
First of all, wishing you a very happy new year to everybody sitting here. I just want to discuss a few things. regarding the exercises that of these patients are generally we are asking them to do, because often they are not able to do hectic exercise as you just mentioned, and we don't want to overload them with more of work. We have seen often that motivating them to start doing simple breathing exercises, deep breathing exercises as they are doing in yoga, it really really makes them like in get involved. And small 5 or 7 minutes episode 5 or 7 minute sessions at home, whenever they are away from hospitals where they cannot come to a specialist center like yours where you have a lovely rehab unit. So there, I think this really works well. When they start doing exercise at home, and then not only this, but all the way stretching exercises, bending exercises. When we talk about lungs, because they are the ones which are fairly severely involved, especially those that are having severe disease. So their hypoxia is of course the issue, and also then they become fatigued very soon. So they cannot undertake strenuous exercises. So we really feel that apart from the routine exercises which can be done in the centers, involving them and the family members in doing yoga, then the deep breathing exercises, and then increasing the frequency and depth, and additional to spirometry, it works well in my experience. Your comments on that, please.
But you are very right on that one needs to understand that any patient of respiratory disease does not need only respiratory exercises. We very well know by the literature now that COPD is now labeled as a systemic disease. Mm-hmm. And even the COVID-19 patients, the survivors from the ICU or the wards who have been on oxygen, they have basically suffered a critical illness disease, and ultimately the whole body is affected, all the systems are affected. So family support is obviously there, as I just said, that logistics, transportation of patients, encouraging the patient to do sessions at home even when they are not coming to the hospital. That is very important. And all the components, not only the respiratory exercises, but aerobic treadmill exercises or anaerobic exercises, strength bearing exercises, they are as important as respiratory exercises, because ultimately the critical illness has made its impact on the complete body and not only the respiratory system.
Agreed. Very, very true.
Very right, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
Dr. Alkesh, you have a note of appreciation from the director. Jodhpur.
Yes, I am very happy to read that.
Yes.
I am very happy to read that. So, any further questions, I'll be more than happy to discuss if there are any. So,
one more question.
Okay, then thank you very much from my side. Thank you everyone from the Jalpaigo team, from our own director, and who has been the force behind organizing these webinars, and to everybody involved in COVID care services from my own hospital. My sincere thanks to everybody for this effort. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Over to Dr. Nachiketa.
On behalf of the USSIS and Jalpaigo teams, would like to thank AIIMS Bhopal and NHM Madhya Pradesh for this engrossing and enlightening series of webinars. I'd like to thank Dr. Alkesh for such a wonderful presentation on pulmonary rehabilitation. I take the liberty of sharing gratitude for this on behalf of all attendees, since COVID management deserves much more knowledge sharing than it is receiving in many such platforms, which we have all visited in the recent times. And the amount of focus that it has received, the lesser amount of focus that it has received, is also evident from the literature review that you shared, Dr. Alkesh.
Thank you.
And so we would like to share our gratitude to you for that, and to the participants for ensuring that this was an interactive session, further enhancing the knowledge of all the attendees. I'd like to also specially thank the AIIMS Jodhpur team, which has always been present, and the director, sir, for always being present for these, ensuring that his team is participating in this. So thank you everyone again for this interactive session, for being a part of it, and to the AIIMS Bhopal team again for ensuring that such a series is being continued throughout. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, everyone.